welcome our guest on the dais by presenting them bouquet. May I request AD NABI to do the honor, please? Lighting a lamp before a ceremony spreads divine grace. The lighting lamp shows everyone how to rise upwards and spread brightness. I would like to humbly request all the dignitaries present on the dais to announce the beginning of this special lecture by lighting the lamp. Please, sir. Thank you, sir. Function, let's dedicate our prayers to Maa Saraswati, Devi of Knowledge. I would like to invite NABI team of girls to please recite Saraswati Vandana, please.
He Sharde Maa, He Sharde Maa, Agyan Dase Hame Tarde Maa, He Sharde Maa, He Sharde Maa.
हे शारदे मा, हे
शारदे माँ, अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ, हमें तार दे माँ, हमें तार दे माँ, हमें तार दे माँ।
थैंक यू गर्ल्स। Now I would like to request Dr. T.R. Sharma, ED NABI and CEO CIAB to please welcome the gathering.
Morning, most respectable chief guest of the day and the speaker, Professor Ajay K. Sood, FRS, President INSA, Professor K. N. Pathak, former Vice Chancellor, Punjab University, Professor Inder V. S. Pasi, Chairperson, Chandigarh Chapter, NASI. Distinguished guest, Dr. R. K. Sinha, Director, CSIO, Dr. Arvind, Director, Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, Dr. Ghosh, Director, INST, and many distinguished professors, colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me welcome you all on my personal behalf as well as on behalf of National Agri-Food Biotechnology Institute and Center of Innovative and Applied Bioprocessing. These are the twin institutes of Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, which were established 10 years back. So you are most welcome to this very important talk, which is being hosted by jointly National Academy of Sciences, Chandigarh Chapter, as well as NABI and CIAB. We are really most excited to receive and welcome Professor Ajay K. Sood, President, Indian National Science Academy, INSA and FRS, for accepting our invitation, sir. It's really a rare occasion when we get such a brilliant speaker and eminent scientist for this type of lectures. I would like to welcome all the students, guests, and specifically the students from St. Joseph School, Sector 43, and also postgraduate student of Chandigarh University, as well as student of INST, ISA, Punjab University, NIPER, NABI and CIAB. So here we have students, staff and professors of many institutions situated in this knowledge city as well as in Chandigarh. It's really a matter of great pride and satisfaction for all of us at NABI that we are going to host this very important talk by the eminent scientist, Professor Ajay K. Sood. Before we start the formal function by Professor IVS Pasi, I would like to tell you a few things about the institute where you are sitting. Sir, this institute is 10 years old. It was established in 2010 in the name of National Agri-Food Biotechnology Institute by the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. We work under Ministry of Science and Technology. And along with that, another institute was built in the same campus named as Center of Innovative and Applied Bioprocessing, which was established in 2012. Our major area of research is working on different aspects of agriculture biotechnology, food biotechnology, and nutritional science. Once we are ready with product using all these three different approaches, then we use the facility of bioprocessing unit where we scale up all those innovations and processes at these institutions and then link with the industry. During past 8 years, our institute was able to deliver a very important product in the form of a wheat line containing high anthocyanin content. The wheat which we eat, it has only 4 ppm anthocyanin, but the line which we have developed, it has 120 ppm anthocyanin, which is an antioxidant. Very important antioxidant, which is very good for our health. And last year we planted this wheat lines in 2 inspirational districts which were identified by Government of India. You know, Government of India has identified 114 inspirational districts throughout the country which were backward. So in Punjab, Moga and Firozpur, these 2 districts were identified by Government of India. We adopted 20 farmers there and we planted this particular wheat variety in organic and non-organic. And you can see 4 trucks standing outside this building. We have brought that whole produce from the farmers and now we are going to develop certain products from that. Another wheat line which my colleagues has developed is very important for people like us who do their job while sitting, diabetic people. We have developed wheat line which is containing resistant starch, around 40 times more than that of resistant existing wheat varieties. The atta which you eat, it's a wheat variety which has around 20% resistant starch, but the line which we have developed 45 to 50%. So this resistant starch is very important for diabetic people, who is slowly digested in your gut. Third technology which is very attractive is to develop it. We have developed a coating for coating the perishable fruits like apple, peach and guava. You know, the apple which you eat and get in the market, very shining apple, that is coated with wax. It's a wax coating, it's animal derived product. It's a product of insects. So we are going to replace that with a coating which is of organic in nature. We have developed it from wheat straw and oat bran. And that is also very important and attractive product which we are going to have from our institute. And within the short span of 8 years, we are linking all our products with the industry. And let me inform you that we have PhD program in biotechnology, and presently we have 130 PhD and postgraduates, postdoctorate students at both the institutes. So the students coming from different organizations, I would request them to kindly also see, and also the guest also requested to see the display which we have made in front of the main gate while going after this lecture. Before I close my talk, I would also like to welcome Professor Garover. He is a mentor to all of us sitting in Knowledge City and guiding all of us in various occasions. Thank you, Dr. Garover, for coming also. So thank you very much and welcome you all.
National Academy of Sciences, India is the first science academy of India. It was established in 1930 with its headquarters at Prayagraj, Uttar Pradesh. May I request Professor Inderbir Singh Pasi, President Chandigarh Chapter of NASI, to please tell the audience about NASI activities, introduce the speaker, and please invite him to deliver his special lecture. Please, sir.
Professor Sood, Professor Patrick, Dr. Sharma, honorable fellows and members of the Chandigarh chapter of the National Academy of Sciences India, faculty and research staff of National Agri-Food Biotechnology Institute, invited guests, students, ladies and gentlemen. I join Dr. Sharma in welcoming all of you to this public lecture, which has been organized jointly by the Chandigarh chapter of the National Academy of Sciences India and the National Agri-Food Biotechnology Institute. Before I introduce today's speaker, allow me to tell you a little bit, very briefly, about the Academy. As just mentioned, the National Academy of Sciences India initially called the Academy of Sciences of United Provinces of Agra and Awadh, was founded in the year 1930 with the objective of providing a national forum for the publication of research work carried out by Indian scientists and to provide opportunities for exchange of views among them. Professor Meghnad Saha was elected as its first president. The Academy, while starting with 57 ordinary members and 19 fellows, has now 1,765 members and 1,812 fellows from all parts of the country, including 17 honorary fellows and 103 foreign fellows from various disciplines of science and technology. The Academy is financially supported by the Department of Science and Technology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India. The Academy has its headquarters at Prayagraj and is currently headed by Professor G. Padmanabhan, former director of the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. The major thrust of the activities run by the Academy is its science and society program. In order to pursue the objectives of the Academy and create an adequate impact of the Academy all over the country, the Academy has 20 local chapters, of which ours is one, with nearly 41 NASI fellows and 36 NASI members. Each of the local chapters is managed by a small committee, a chairman, secretary, and a couple of advisors. The Chandigarh chapter has been headed by Professor K. N. Patik for the 5 years from 2013 until last year. Last year, the council reorganized the committee for the Chandigarh chapter, and the responsibility has been given to me as chairman, Professor Tilkraj Sharma as secretary, and Professor K. N. Patik, Professor Ravindra Kumar Kohli, and Professor Devi Prasad as advisors. It's in pursuance of the objectives of the Academy that this event has been organized by the Chandigarh chapter of NASI in collaboration with NABI. We are highly grateful to Professor Ajay K. Sood for agreeing to our request to deliver the public lecture today. Professor Sood obtained his BSc and MSc degrees from the Punjab University, Chandigarh, in 1971-72 respectively. That apparently must have been a very bright class. It has given us the Vice Chancellor, Professor Arun Kumar Grover, and as you see today's speaker, and perhaps some of his class fellows also went very high in academic circles. Professor Sood immediately joined the Bach Training School while posted as a scientist at the Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research, Kalpakkam. He was awarded PhD degree by the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore in 1982. After postdoctoral research at Max Planck Institute in Stuttgart, Germany, followed by a brief period of service at IGCAR, he joined IISc Bangalore in 1988, where he continues to serve till now, currently as an honorary professor in the Department of Physics there. Professor Ajay K. Sood has made outstanding contributions in both hard and soft condensed matter that are profound in terms of experimental discovery as well as theoretical understanding. Most of his research in condensed matter has strong overlap with material science and engineering. Some of his research interests lie at the interface between physics and biology. He has developed some of the finest experimental techniques, applied them to discover many fascinating natural phenomena, and used them to design sensitive devices for practical applications. His publications, totaling close to 400 so far, cover a wide range of topics. Several of his innovations have been patented. He has guided more than 30 PhD theses. Professor Sood is an elected fellow of all the three national science academies in India and the World Academy of Sciences, known as TWAS. In 2015, Professor Sood was elected a fellow of the Royal Society, London. At present, he is the president of the Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi. He was Secretary General of TWAS from 2013 to 18. Earlier, he served as president of the Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore, during 2010 to 2012. Professor Sood has been honored with a large number of prestigious awards, which include the Shanti Srubhatnagar Award, Tuas Prize, Birla Science Award. It's a long list, so I will summarize only a few of them. At the national level, Professor Sood has served as member Scientific Advisory Council to the Prime Minister of India from 2009 to 2014, member of Science and Engineering Research Board from 2012 to 2014, Chairman Council Raman Research Institute, and many other very distinguished assignments. In recognition of his scientific contributions and services to science in India, Professor Sood has been honored with Padma Shri by the Government of India in 2013. Today, Professor Sood has chosen to speak to us on why do we flock together. Professor Sood.
Professor Pasi, Dr. T. R. Sharma, distinguished people all over the hall, students, faculty, it's absolutely a delight for me to be here. It's a homecoming, so much so that I was here last week where I gave a talk in CSIO, but the topic is different. And I have been coming to Chandigarh on and off. Because my alma mater is here, and Professor Pathak was my teacher, and Arun Grover, my very close friend. We did master's, BSc and MSc in 1972. I'm losing track of time. So it has been absolutely a delight for me to be again coming to Chandigarh. And I would like to thank Professor Pasi and Dr. Sharma for making it possible for me to talk to you today. Now, today's talk actually is a developing story in my lab, and this is not my core theme of the work. I do many things, and this is an interest I developed a few years back, about 5 years back. And I'll tell you this story in a relaxed manner, minimizing all the technicalities, but not diluting it beyond a point, so that you get a feel of what we are up to. And I feel very small when I hear Dr. Sharma telling all this beautiful application and societal implications. This story, I'll tell you a story on that when somebody asked me what is the implication of our work. But this work is just for you to enjoy. Forget all everything else, just enjoy the story. And if you take any message, then let me know later. So I would tell you what interested us, and this is a phenomena which is inspired by nature. So this flocking is something you all know. It's an English word which stands for moving together in a very coherent manner. And you have heard the phrases in your school, birds of the same flock fly together. All those things are there. So the question we are asking is there a minimal understanding of this beautiful phenomena which is seen all the time in nature? And I will give you some examples where you see this. Now, if you watch under a microscope some dirty water, you will see this bacteria moving. These are E. coli, which is not good if they are in the food. And you will see that they are moving quite independent of each other. So this is the case when you have few E. coli in water. But now you concentrate them and see under a microscope. And then something very interesting occurs. in that time, you can see that many, many of them are moving coherently, where they are moving together as a flock. Is it clear, or do we need to switch off this light? But then you will sleep, so that is another problem. So you have to decide between less clear lights and sleeping tendencies. So let's keep the lights on. All right. So this is something you see in bacteria, which is not alone. And if you happen to go to a forest, you can see on the ground, if you walk, sometimes you will see these ants going around. They can go left or right, but this is what in literature is called ant mills. So you can Google it. There are very beautiful photographs. This is one of such videos. And these are again moving very coherently when the numbers are large. Then if you take locusts and put it on a petri dish and you increase their number, this is an actual experiment from another group, you will see that they are moving together. And they do not move together if their numbers are small. So this is a phenomena which occurs beyond a certain concentration of this locus. And this is another beautiful video I have taken from YouTube. There are many of them. And this is what is called murmuration, which means all the starlings or mynas, as they call in Hindi, they will fly in the sky, and you will see there is a beautiful sound which is not coming. Okay, don't worry. So this one you will see. Actually, can you switch off at least one of the lights? Then. Sound is coming, but it's this cannot be switched off probably. I think it should be fine, right? That's good. So you can see that thousands and thousands of birds are making this beautiful formation, and they are flying in the sky. Then they move to some other place, and then again perform this very beautiful collective motion. This is again you can see that these are not a few thousand, many, many thousand birds are really flying as if they are being directed to fly in a very coherent fashion. And these are the amateur photographers which have put it on the YouTube. There are many things from India you can see, from Madurai and so on, they have been loaded on the web. Now, if you go to other animals, namely us, and if you go to a heavy metal concert, by the way, this has been published in Physical Review Letters, one of the most prestigious journal in physics. So I don't want to trivialize this, but it's a very beautiful physics which they have discussed why animals also like us, they move coherently when actually there is a nice music which is not coming, but you will see that even in a lodi, if you get many of you together, the very natural tendency is to go collectively in a manner that you don't kick each other, and then you survive that evening. So all these are phenomena which are called flocking. And so let me define flocking with a very defining word here. So this is a collective motion of organisms by sensing each other's presence, orientation and direction. But the most important message which you should take home today, that it is an emergent behavior arising from simple rules followed by individuals. There is no central coordination here. There is no central command which is telling each one to behave. They cooperate among themselves and form this collective motion. So the defining word is emergent, which is the new behavior you get when you have many of them together. And there is no central coordination is the theme. Now, this is a phenomena which has been around for centuries, and early papers have really wondered what is the reason for flocking. So you will see some very intricate papers which tell you that there is a telepathic communication between birds, that's why they are forming flock, or in the ants. Human beings, we always believed in telepathy, though never proved. Or there are mental templates of orderly movement. So very fancy theories have been put forward before my story starts. So this story has been there for a long time, and people have always wondered, what is it that makes such a flock? So this question was asked, and this is the first paper in scientific community, especially in physics and engineering, which showed with a very simple computer program, you can download on your laptop or a smartphone. It's called BOID, which stands for bird and oids. And he showed, Craig Reynolds showed, that if you put three ingredients in your algorithm, which is a very simple software, one, that you need repulsion between particles so they don't come and hug each other. Second, you put attraction, which means they steer towards average position of neighbors. So you have both repulsion and attraction in the right amount. And alignment, very important, that you steer towards average heading of the neighbors. So you look around back forth and you then get aligned. With these three simple rules on a computer program, without any leadership or any plan, he showed that you can get many features of flocking, just nearest neighbor interaction. So again, I have taken this program from one of the websites. So you can see that they are moving together. This also comes and gets. Now you put obstacle and ask, how do they?
First rule here is alignment, and I'll just put a bunch of guys out here for fun.
Very good. So this is
what each void does is it looks to its neighbors, its friends, in kind of a small radius.
Get all this, those three,
maybe about two or three body lengths.
So this program very clearly brought out that there is, it is jumping ahead of me. There is no top-down orders required. There is no mental template required. There is no telepathic communication. You don't need any of that to get the flocking. So this revolutionized also, I thought many people don't know, this simple program has been used in Hollywood a lot. In early 1990, 87 was the program, and a lot of Hollywood movies have used this program, and I'll give you one glimpse of it, which you may not have realized, such a simple program. This was used in Batsman Return. It was then related software called Massive. It is used in Lords of the Ring series, and so on. So I just took that when you see these flocks or the things moving in the movies, it is most likely done by this program. So I will show you one where Batman Return. You can see these bats moving. Actually, you can see it's almost the Boyd's program, which is really running this. Actually, it's a bit longer one, but I can YouTube it. So all these flocks of the bats which move actually were run using this program. Another movie, again, many of the kids might have seen it,
is quick, where this program
stampede in the gorge. So this is just Simba's down there. Simba.
All right. So this was just to show that this has also made millions of dollars in process. So now remind you that this flocking is a collective obsession. The way individuals work together is more important than they work alone, and you get an order without central command. That is very important in flocking. And this is what simple rules, you can show that order emerges. And this whole concept, this scientific concept, that you have emergent behavior by individual interaction and communication, it has given rise to many, many things. And this is called that you have to avoid collision. So the similar algorithms are used. You can, these are called flocking algorithms, swarm algorithms in computer science. And they are very important for autonomous cars, the cars without drivers. So all these flocking swarm algorithms, if you Google it, they all use this principle of which I said that it's an emergent behavior. So this is something beyond just natural phenomena or beyond the experiments I'll show you. So this is a very nice review article which has appeared recently, and it is called The Physics of Life. And I'll read for you so that you can laugh. For flocking, from flocking birds to swarming molecules, physicists are seeking to understand active matter and looking for a fundamental theory of the living world. It's a tall claim, but it conveys the message that what we do in physics is to try out a minimal model, minimal understanding of this complicated phenomena, and see whether we understand the phenomena. So I will now give you a glimpse of our experiments, what we have done, and what we have done to go beyond what was known so far in this field. So experiments are very simple. So what we have is a shaker. So you can buy this shaker, and if you don't have money, you can use the speaker phone, and the speaker will vibrate and this will work for you. You can connect it to a frequency generator. So what we do on this vibrator, we put a plate, and on that plate we put the particles which are made of aluminium or brass. So these beads are the aluminium beads, and this green one is a brass rod. The diameter is 1 millimeter, 0.8 millimeter, and length is about 4 millimeter, 3 or 4 millimeter. And now you shake it with a very small amplitude, as small as 0.1 millimeter. You can't even see, but and at a certain frequency, which is what I have given here, it's a very small amplitude, 0.02 millimeter, with some frequency, 200 hertz. So you accelerate the particles. That's all you need, small acceleration. So this energy is given to these particles, and now they will do very beautiful motion, which is what we call the directed motion, which means they will move in a given direction as long as you vibrate. So here we are mimicking nature. You, of course, you have to give fuel to the living animals like bacteria or birds or human beings. Here our energy is the energy from the vibrated surface, and the particle is like our motor, which is like a biological motor, and it is now the orientation of the particle sets the motion, and this is what I'll show you in the movie. So what we do, we put this particle and on a plate, empty plate, you can see this particle is moving. This particle is moving as long as we vibrate it. You stop the vibration, it will stop moving. Now if you put them on a ring, on a track, you can see this particle. This is moving ballistically. So if you ask how is the position changing, it is velocity into time, high school physics. So it is not a diffusive motion, which is what we usually encounter. So this is a ballistic motion as done by bacteria or birds or fishes or all these living animals. So we work with these inanimate objects, and if I change the shape of the particle, you can get very, very interesting behavior. Instead of one step, I put one step in the brass rod, and now you can see the motion has changed. Now it is doing run and tumble. It moves, then it tumbles, moves. So some of you who are in biology will recognize it is similar to E. coli, run and tumble motion. So this is something now you can play with the motion, what kind of motion you want. So first experiment which we did was an extraordinarily simple experiment. We said, let's put this mover, which we call the active particle, in a crowd. Crowd is made of spherical beads. They do not move because they are spherical. They keep on remain at the same place when you vibrate. And we just asked, I told the student, just look at its motion and see what happens. You will see what is there. It's so boring. It's just moving. So this is like a person moving in a crowd. So what we saw was that when you now plot velocity as a function of time, this is positive velocity, this is negative velocity. On the average, it is moving forward. But every few milliseconds, it goes backward. Forward, backward. So the question we asked was, is it just noise or is it some science into it? That's the question. And you'll be surprised that it has some very deep science. I'll hint at that science. I will not give the details, but it is something which is counterintuitive. And that physics is called physics of fluctuations in a non-equilibrium system. Non-equilibrium means you have to give energy. What this theorem shows is the following. High school tells us, high school physics, that heat will always flow from hot to cold. That's how your spoon gets heated up. When you heat spoon, your hand gets warm. Question is, can you ask whether the heat can flow from cold to hot? In the school, you will never be taught that you can have the flow reverse. This question is not stupid, actually. This question does not violate any laws of thermodynamics. Answer is, you also have these events, which are called rare events, but majority of the events are what you know by common sense. Then there is a theorem, it's called fluctuation theorem. I will not go into detail. It's a very large subject in itself, which showed that these rare events have a mathematical relation to the positive events. It's a very deep theorem. It's called the entropy production theorem. And I will not give you all the details. There is a mathematical relation. And what we showed in that work a few years back, that the negative velocity events of that mover in a crowd follows exactly this theorem. We still do not understand why it follows this theorem, but this theorem is deeper than what people thought. So this is just a big surprise, even from those simple experiments which we showed. My focus this morning is on collective behavior. So I'll show you what we look at. So this is again to say that it is motivated by this natural phenomena, which I showed in the first slide, namely the ant mill and the marching locust. And we would like to see, can we mimic this in the laboratory? And if we can mimic, what can we learn? Now, all these things, last slide paper is published in Science. And what I'll show you is our experiment from now on. So what we do is, we take these many particles and put them on a plate. So we said, flock, they should flock because they should form a collective motion. And we did this experiment. Sorry, it's not playing. I don't know why it's not. It doesn't matter. I think there must be some problem with my... You can still still see it, right? I'll play from here. So you can see that these particles are moving, but they are never forming that beautiful flock which we see in birds or fishes. They are moving more or less independently. But then we immediately realize that there is no way these brass particles communicate to each other. Because how will they communicate? Birds have a way of communicating, ants have a way of communicating. How will brass rods communicate? So we need to put eyes and ears on these rods. And we can do that by putting something in between. So what we did, we put the beads, aluminium beads, so that they communicate the motion of one particle to the next particle. I'll show you how. And now we said, okay, let's do that. If we put sufficiently good numbers, I don't know why it's not playing today. And what I want to just show you the final result, that if we put sufficient particles, yeah. So what we have done is we have put sufficient number of beads, and now we show that within a minute they all start moving together. So now the particles are communicating to each other what they are doing, and now they are moving together. So the beauty is now that you need something to communicate, which we identify, we find out how much they are moving together. And this is the, let's see. Sorry, I didn't realize some issue with my software. So now you can see that I have put 40% beads and 6% rods, only 6%. You can see that they are not moving coherently. But now I increase the beads to 68% because we need enough communication. And now you see that now this is real time movie, that now within about 150 seconds they all start moving coherently. So the moral of the story is that you need communication between the rods provided by the beads. So why? Because when the rods move, they disturb beads, and beads communicate to another rod. So this is the kind of phase diagram you will get. What it means, I'll translate for the students. What it means is that if you have 10% rods, you will need about 45% beads to see flocking. But if you decrease the number of rods to 5%, then you will need 55% beads to communicate, which is what naturally you will expect. So if you have sufficient number of rods, sufficient number of beads, and beads are the major players, they are communicating, you can get the flocking, and then you can get jamming and so on. So this is something we now can ask, what is the role of the bead medium? So as I communicated few minutes back, they really communicate, they are the eyes and ears for mediating interaction between the particles. Because without them, the active particles cannot communicate with each other. So when now we show what is the medium doing, what is the role of the beads. And here we see something very interesting. If you look at the position where they are not moving coherently, all the rods are moving randomly. Now we see the beads. We also look at the beads' velocity and direction because we have all the images. Now you can see, which you can't see from the back, all the beads are moving randomly. They have no cooperation in beads. which is what you would expect. But the beauty is that as soon as you go to a position where you have the coherent motion of the rods, and now you look at the beads, they also move together in a beautiful fashion. They form vortices and so on. So what has happened is the activity of the rods has been now communicated coherently to activity of the beads. Beads were completely passive if the rods are not there, but in the presence of rods, they also become very exciting. Now, this interaction has a lot of relevance in biology. In biology, you know there are motors, motor proteins are there. That's how you move your arm. Now, those proteins, when they move, the other things with which they interact, which are not motor proteins, can get organized. So they can, by interaction, make some other activity in the other systems which could have some implications. So this is how we quantify their order parameter, and this is a snapshot which tells you, we look at this bead, for example, as a function of, rod, and you can see that within about 8 seconds, it starts forming a part of the crowd, and in 22 seconds, it is subsumed. So what is happening is, I'll just summarize this slide, that the moving rods lead to bead flow, and the resulting bead flow aligns the neighboring rod. So it's a feedback. So when the rod moves, the beads get active, and these bead activity translate to the far off rod, and rod comes into place. So this is the way, which is a very new, it's a new paradigm in flocking, where we are showing that you don't have to only interact with the neighbors, nearest neighbor. All the existing theories just need the interaction with the nearest neighbor. Here we are showing that even if this particle is very, very apart, 20 diameters apart, it can form a part of the flock. So if you have a way to communicate the interaction long distances, you can have flocking. So this has some implication in the theoretical understanding of this. So I will not give all the details. I will probably tell you that now, so we have understood this in computer simulation, which allows us to go in more detail on the physics of it. So this is the simulation where you synthesize a rod. This is the experimental rod. This is the computer rod on the in the program. You mimic it and you put it on the plate in the computer, not computer, in the program, and you give the motion and you write the Newton's law, law of restitution, whatever is simple physics, and see if you can simulate this physics. And I will not give you detail. And this is something. This is the computer experiment. The red are the beads. These are the rods. And when the numbers are not appropriate, they do not form a flock. But now you put enough numbers in the computer of the beads and the rods, and now you can see almost like an experiment. So this is computer simulation. This is the power of computer simulation, which allows you to go back and see what physics you are putting. Now, is that what you need? But here I'll give you something more than that. Computer experiments allow us to go beyond the lab experiments. The reason is, if you ask me, oh, you have a circular rod, plate, and you are going in the circles. Is that the only, is that the physics decided by the plate geometry? Answer is yes, but it is not a phenomena only coming because of the circular geometry, which we cannot test in a laboratory, because you cannot do on a, let's say, football ground and look at the imaging. So what we do is we simulate in computer and what is called periodic boundary condition. So you mimic an infinite system on the computer, and what we showed was that in the infinite system also you get this beautiful flocking, but now they will not be forming the circular flocks, but they'll be moving together. You can see that? So computer experiments allow you to do those experiments which you cannot do in the lab, and you can really go behind the science of this. So now I will not go into theory, which is not the intention, but the point is you can write now, you can ask how rods are interacting with beads, how the bead flow aligns it, you can all mathematically write that, and we showed at that time that this interaction between the two leads to a collective behavior. So let me summarize it. I have about 10 minutes. I forgot when 10:30 we started. Okay, 10 minutes. Okay, when you get fed up, you can raise your hands. So let me summarize this last part. So we showed there is a formation of flock in a collection of dry grains, and this is something very important, which I again want to emphasize, that a small concentration of motile particles can carry a cargo which is really passive, which is very unusual. The beads were completely passive, but now they also become active. So what is now beyond this, I'll show you one or two results recently, and then close this talk. So what we have shown is now that you take these active particles without beads now, and we wanted to see, can you trap them when they are moving all over? Can I concentrate them? Why is this question important? Supposing you have all the bacteria moving in your beaker and you want to concentrate them. Is there a way? Or do you want to concentrate the fishes? Or you want to concentrate something else? Can you have a way of doing it? So what we show you is the principle of that. So what we are doing is, on the plate, we are putting a wedge with different angles. And what we show now, that when you change the angle below a certain value, let me show you the movie itself without wasting time. Sorry, it's again not playing. Some reason. I'll show you that if this movie had played at 80 degrees, all these particles which were outside, they will come inside. And if you increase the angle to 120 degrees, they all go out. So there is a phase transition which is separating non-trapped, trapping and the non-trapping state. Here you can see they will come in, but they will go out. Come in, go out. So you can look at the statistic. There is a lot of physics here which I will not discuss, but let me show you the earlier slide, probably a snapshot. You can see here, these are the snapshots. As you decrease the angle below 120 degrees, they will start forming the trapping. So experiment is very simple. We do different experiments with different trap angle. So this is like a funnel in a three dimension. So we put a funnel in two dimension. This is because on a plate. And what we show is that they come together if there is angle below a critical angle. This is what I showed you, and again we could simulate this effect, and I'll tell you the message. So this is the resultant slide, that if you plot how many particles are trapped, this is all the particles are trapped up to a certain angle, which is close to 120 degree, and then they are never trapped. They are trapped, but they go out. Trapped, go out. So this is something very interesting, which we also could simulate, and there are messages which I will not show you. Near the critical angle, many, many funny things happen. Particles will come inside, stay for some time, and break the collective thing. Come inside, break. Come inside, break. Then you can ask, how much time will they stay without breaking? What will happen to them when the angle is slightly different? So many questions are here which I will not answer, but you can now simulate this. with a message. So what we have done here in the computer experiment, we have put the same rod, same shape, there is no difference now, but we give rotational noise in the computer program, which is different. One of the rods is not moving much, tilting much, other rod is very, very agile. And what we show is that only the rods which are persistent will only get trapped. So it's a very unusual message, not good for students, that if you are persistent in motion, you will get trapped. So you have to be fidgety to remain moving, which means never get satisfied in your life. Which means you go, but never let the other person predict what you're going to do. So the particles which are unpredictable never get trapped. So unpredictability makes them highly agitated or whatever you may call, and they don't get trapped. So this is the message from computer experiments which we have quantified. So let me give the take-home message and then I'll wind up soon, that a non-equilibrium phase transition to a collectively trapped state, and here the persistent movers are trapped, and now based on this, can we do something more? So that's what I'll ask you, show you the results. So this is the experiment, real life experiment by bacteria another lab, and what they have shown is much before our experiment, that they have put a funnel with 60 degree angle, and they showed at that time that bacteria all gathered together in the funnel. And what we are showing is that there is a critical angle below which it will happen, and above which this collective thing, this trapping will not happen. So now, okay, I will not discuss this. In our recent paper, which is now on PhysRevE, we have now found out what is the theory behind. Why is there a critical angle? So there is a very, very interesting physics behind, which is related to a very counterintuitive phenomena in active matter. Now, counterintuitive phenomena is, you will think that when the particles are very active, they will never clump. There is no attraction between them. You will think they will never attract. In these computer experiments, it is shown that if you have many large number of them and put it on the plate, they will form clumps only when the number is large. And this is called, a very interesting name, motility induced phase separation, which means they are getting together because of motility. It's counterintuitive. And what they have shown is that once they are very mobile, they tend to form clusters, which is very counterintuitive. And what we have shown in our experiments, it is related to this, but this occurs at a very high volume fraction, very large number of particles. In our case, it's a very small number of particles, but the trapping, the jail, the cage helps them to get together. So I will not give you the theoretical underpinning, which is what we have done and shown that you can get a phase transition. Now going further, how can we use it? So what we have shown is that if you take mixture of two kinds of active particles, which are having different statistical behavior, how they move, can you sort them out based on their activity, not on their size? So they are the same size, but they move differently. So what we do, we put two types of particle. One of the particles is what I showed you. This is what, it's not moving, it's called run and tumble. Sorry, this is the one which is run and tumble, I showed you earlier. And the other one is a persistent motion. So what we are showing now, actually, we put them together on a plate with a wedge which is less than 120 degrees. And now you can see in real time, you will only get trapped this kind of particle, which is persistent, which is moving. the one which is run and tumble never gets trapped. So if you have different types of motile particles which have different behavior, or if you have different crowd, two types of crowd, the ones which are very agitated, one which are straightforward moving, you can see how to trap one of them and not the other. So this have possible some applications for bacteria. So I'll now close this talk to tell you an anecdote, and this is what I showed, that after our paper appeared, there were lots and lots of newspaper reports that what has that to do with the flocking and so on. And one of the very newspaper made this headline, and I told this story somewhere else, but this is the real story, that this reporter, that's how I have been reported wrongly today in newspaper. So newspaper today has reported that you said yesterday that about the funding, I mentioned it is 0.8% of GDP which India is spending, unlike China which is spending much more, Korea 4% and so on. This was a question by the reporters yesterday after the convocation. And I said, there is a persistent effort by all the science academies, ministers and everything to make that 0.8% as 2%. Minimum 2%, because then India will really flourish in science and technology. So this is what I said yesterday. So today's newspaper Indian Express reports that President INSA says that India is spending only 0.2% of GDP, and it is too small. So I'm sure in Delhi there will be a lot of now cry. So 2% became 0.2, and 0.8 disappeared from their notes. So this sometime talking to newspapers can be at your own risk. So this person, Deccan Herald, he asked me, what is the use of your experiments to society? Like NABI is doing so much society things. So you have a reason to spend money. What are you doing by this flocking experiment? And I had no answer, frankly, because we were doing it just to understand the basic physics. So I told him, no, there is no use. So he said, no, this cannot be correct. Otherwise, why should government of India spend money on you? So I told him, and this is where I was thinking that evening, there was a very tragic incident that evening in Chhath festival in Bihar. On the bridge, there was a stampede and few people had died. And you know, in Makkah and Medina, there are always stampedes, which has become a huge issue, but now, not now. So this was bothering me, that is there a scientific understanding of this stampede? What is a stampede? Stampede is when all the active particles or active people rush towards something, either because there is an emergency like fire in the room, or there is a food outside, not for you, but for some other people, and you want to grab the food. This is how the experiments are being done, I'll tell you, using sheep. So the idea is, can you have a scientific understanding of this phenomena? And this is not something, so I told him that, oh, we will solve stampede problem. And he said, how? So I gave him some vague answer at 10 in the night, and next day it appeared. Experiments may provide solution to stampede. So this is the way newspapers report, but this report made us really now think. I told my student, we are in trouble, because this is something I have said, we have not done any experiments, what can we do? So I got a summer student from ISER Trivandrum, and I suggested him this problem. So I'll tell you what he did in summer. It's a 1 month project. But this problem is actually very deep. It's something which is not fully understood. So there is a person, a professor of computational social science in Zurich. He is actually a computer scientist. Dirk Helbing. This is what he looks like. And he has worked on this whole phenomena of collective behavior. And he calls this stampede and so on as a turbulent flow. And he applies the hydrodynamic theory to this phenomena. So it's a very exciting field in mathematics and computer science to understand this collective behavior. And the reason they have done is that the statistic shows that in Mecca, about 3 million people go every year, and 215 stampedes have occurred. 215, it's not a small number, between 1980 and 2007. And after 2007, this number has come down. Why? Because they contacted physicists. And physicists have given a solution on how to design the doors and how to design the hall, that place. So it's a very physics problem of this collective behavior and so on. So this is one of the work from, let's say, their group, and they show that crowd turbulence, the physics of crowd disaster, they show that if the critical density, it has nothing to do with our work, but it's a very interesting fact. If you have 5 to 10 people per square meter in a room, and there is an emergency to go out, and you don't have sufficient appropriate doors, you will have stampede, you will have jamming. So at this time, all the people will come to the door and you will not be able to go out. So it's a study which they have done in the computer. And many people are trying to do this because it has relevance to traffic, not in Chandigarh, but in Bangalore. And you can have grains clogging the hopper. You can have arteries getting clogged. You can have panic flow of human beings or sheep. And this is how experiments are done. So this is from one of the labs in Spain, and they take the sheep and they put them in a room, and then they put different designs of doors and different numbers of sheep. There is a very beautiful paper on this. You can see this. These are not sheep, sorry. These are you and me. They have done experiments on human beings with the limited value, and they have shown the size of the door is not that important alone. So what they have shown is that supposing I am 1 foot in size, which of course is wrong, I am more. But if I say I put a door which is 2 feet wide, will it allow a stampede or will it avoid stampede? Will it not let stampede happen? What they have shown with the sheep, which is very eye-opener, the doors is not what it matters. You put an obstacle in the door. So instead of 3 feet door, you make 1.5 feet, 1.5 feet. That works better than a 3 feet door. So there are various designs which work out to avoid stampede. So there is a very beautiful physics on this. So what we have done in a limited way with this summer student, that we took this, not sheep, for us because these are the sheep. So I took these rods, and you can see what we have shown is, again, I don't know why it's not playing. You can see that when I take 200 rods, but 100, 150, 200, and keep the door size same, twice the diameter, you can see that in this case they will not be stampeded, and in this case it takes a very long time to vacate the room. So this is what is happening, and you can also play, you can vary the diameter or you can vary the numbers. So the moral of the story is that, sorry, it's not playing the movie, that if you have the appropriate numbers and appropriate door size, you can avoid stampede. And this is the jamming physics which we do in these experiments. He is the student who did this, and this is something which we need to understand. So let me summarize my finish my talk. What is the take home message from this? That we see collective behavior in many species: birds, fishes, locusts, ants, human beings, and so on. And why it occurs? So now the question which everyone is asking is it the different behavior with same outcome or same underlying basic rules? What is it? Is it the same rule which governs all these species, or there is something more? So there is no single opinion on this. So this is a very hot debated topic, that is physics capturing everything? You know everything about it, now you can go home. Or the appropriate specific interaction between ants, which can be through chemicals or through birds, how they communicate, what is that role to play? So it's not a done deal. And there is a very interesting paper by a very famous scientist. I'll show you his quotation. It's called Professor Ian Cousin from Constance. And this is the experiment I showed you, right? On locusts. And now they have done experiment to show that the reason they are forming this is not to help each other, but really to save themselves, because the locusts try to eat the other one. They try to bite the next one. So this guy doesn't want to be bitten by the fellow behind. So in order to avoid getting bitten up or eaten, this guy keeps on moving. So it is really the cannibalism, not the cooperation, which is responsible in this experiment. In birds, it is opposite. In birds, when birds move, there is a hydrodynamic flow. In that flow, the other bird will get a benefit. It will not spend energy. And you keep on changing the leaders. So there is a different reason for all this behavior, and human beings may follow locusts because they don't want to be kicked from behind, and so on. So, and what they did, they removed the gene from the locusts which make them feel the pinch. And when they did that, the locusts ate each other and there was no flocking. So it's a very, very interesting question to ask, what is actually happening? So it is not a very done deal, and you need to really look at some details, but also most of it is very basic science, basic physics, which is governing. So this is the flocking, which it inspires us to look at this, and this the actual reasoning and all still has to come up in a major way. And what I wanted to show in this talk, that it started with basic curiosity, which is namely the flocking, and it has led to many applications like artificial intelligence, autonomous cars, and so on. So let me close this talk by acknowledging the people who did the work. So this part of it was Nitin's thesis. Harsh is a theory student with Shriram, my close collaborator, and Rahul is the new student who is doing some of the simulations. So with this, I thank you all, and thank you once again.
Thank you, Ajay, for a exciting and very interesting talk. Personally, I felt soothing to my mind. It was so soothing that I really enjoyed, particularly the 3/4 of the talk. I really relished it. My mind was so soothing that I was deriving pleasure out of it. Well, I am asked to conclude the talk, but I will not do that. I would request the speaker to probably answer some of the questions from the audience. But only comment I can make at this point of time is that the cooperative phenomenon is a universal. It has application all over. As you can see from the basic physics to the biology. And we start learning it from very beginning. And the question which he was posing, that what keeps it going, that the nature of the forces actually, probably varies and give rise to different kind of cooperative phenomena, and having wide applications across the the spectrum, as you can see. So I think I would now invite the students to ask questions, whatever they feel like. I am pretty sure that there must be many questions about these floating phenomena in the nature. And human mind is, I am sure, is capable of handling coming problems which society is facing at the moment. So please. Yes? Any question?
Thank you, sir. Though I am not a physicist, but I would like to know the size of the particle and the attraction forces between the similar particles. How do they affect the flocking?
Okay, I probably said it. The particles are the brass rods which are moving, and the length is about 3-4 millimeter, and diameter is about 0.8 millimeter, and the beads are about 1 millimeter in size. These are aluminium beads. We wanted non-magnetic for a technical reason. I can talk later. And what is the second part of the question? How the attraction? Please remember, in this case, there is no physical attraction between brass rods, because these are just macroscopic objects. So the interaction is through the beads. So when the rod is moving, the beads are churned. So that flow makes is a elastic wave which reaches the other rod and communicates this direction to this direction. So it's a we do not have a full theory for it as of now, but that is the work which is getting completed on microscopic understanding of this. So what is it that gives rise? So it's a very interesting thing. The interaction is mediated by the medium.
Waves,
elastic waves, and that is the reason. Yeah, some, yeah.
Good question. Good question.
When it comes to flocking, it doesn't matter whether it is a living organism or non-living.
Correct. So what I showed was, in a limited way, in living organisms, I showed you many examples of ants, fishes, birds. Many of them show collective behavior. We are trying to mimic that to get a basic understanding in an inanimate object. So the message from this talk is, and that is what Craig Reynolds showed in a computer experiment, that with if you have the basic rules, can you get a lot of it understood, not the entirely, and what is the message? So he showed attraction, repulsion, and alignment are responsible. And we have shown even beyond that now, that even if the particles are very far apart and they can have this elastic wave interacting with the two, you can have flocking. So that's the one. So it occurs in living objects as well as non-living.
What is more important, like shape of material or type of material? What will happen if we use beads as well as rods of brass material?
So what matters is the anisotropy in the particle. As long as the moving object is asymmetric, it can be of the same shape, exactly cylinder, but this can be heavier than this. For example, this can be lead, this can be copper. It will do the same thing. So what matters is any asymmetry. So in chemical imitators, what people have done, not us, but many other people, they take a cylinder, they put platinum on one side and gold on this side, and they put in water which has H2O2 peroxide, hydrogen peroxide, which reacts preferentially with one metal and generates hydrogen, the right reaction chemistry guy knows. So that asymmetry makes these things move. So any asymmetry is good. It can be chemical asymmetry, it can be weight asymmetry. In our case, it is shape asymmetry. Any asymmetry will do.
About symmetry of beads?
Beads by design, we have put spherical, which do not move on their own. So this is a combination of active and passive. Now, other experiments which we have done, which we have not, I have not included because it's still underway. Now, can you interrupt a flock? So what we have, people have done, for example, they will put obstacles. So when the birds move, if they get an obstacle like a pole, their flock will be disturbed. So people have found out now, very recently, last year in a Nature paper, physics paper, what is the minimum number of obstacles you need to disturb a flock. But what we are asking is not that. What we are saying is, supposing you have two types of birds, one which form flock, one which hate flock. If you put them together, what is the minimum number of haters which will disrupt the flock? So it's a moving obstacle. So it's a very interesting answer, which I'll tell you in my next lecture.
Yeah, sir. Regarding, I have the question which was similar to in line. So regarding the shape and anisotropy you talked about. So can we really now the change the aspect ratio to modulate the speed of the particle moving? That's number one. And number two is that now whatever you showed, that is actually rigid anisotropic rod. Instead of that, if we make it little more flexible, like spring-like things, which is what probably as a chemist we can think of. That is one thing. That is the first question. Can we really do something on that, and what change?
Answer is yes, and it's a very interesting question, which probably it should make you think. If we can introduce internal degrees of freedom for a moving particle, in our case, moving particle is moving like this. But supposing I can make this particle with internal degrees of freedom, then there will be competition between internal degrees of freedom and the external degree of freedom. Answer is not known. So there are some experiments we have in mind, but it depends. But very little is known in cooperative behavior when you have internal degrees of freedom. So let me say, are there computer people, scientists I don't know in this audience, actually it's a very important question for algorithms. I told you there are swarm algorithms which have the flocking, all those things. So here the point is whether each subroutine has a mind of its own and also the interaction. So the question now is, can you make intelligent particles, put intelligence in the active particle? Our particles are stupid because they are moving only in one direction. If you can make them intelligent, you will get a very rich behavior, and it could have biological implication. Answer is yes.
And sir, lastly, that particle, they actually they have a kind of negative velocity, like, you know, the small.
No, the good question. But let me.
Because you see, sir, if you look at, let's say, movement of sperm, let's say, so they kind of swim, and the head is actually ahead.
So what they are doing, very correct.
Yeah.
So they are going like this, then they go back little bit, then go back forward, go backward. So this motion we analyzed, and what we showed was, which was the very flashing slide I showed, not flashing in the, I mean the slide which I showed in a jiffy, that the actually negative velocity events are not that arbitrary. They have a mathematical relation to the positive events. And that theorem has been derived based on symmetry. So we don't know why we are seeing it. I don't know the deeper answer. But it's very exciting that different that physics of heat flow from hot to cold and asking what is the cold to hot probability is getting the same answer as positive events and negative events. I don't know the answer why, but it is there.
Should come from the students,
yeah.
Can I ask one question? So the particles are moving because of momentum transfer of the objects. So if you go down the size where the viscosity force dominates,
so viscosity is not relevant here because there is no liquid here. So it is all dry thing. When you put viscosity, they will have a damping effect. So energy will be dissipated in that. Our dissipation is coming only when they interact with the plate and they get damped. So that's the difference. So we have not brought in the viscosity of the medium.
So that's the small difference.
So there will be a certain size limitation you can do where the momentum transfer. So there will be a certain size limitation where you can do the momentum transfer.
No. It is all the time there is a momentum transfer from the particle to the plate. It's a dissipative system. What we do, we keep the particle same, but we give different acceleration by making it move differently. And there is a regime of activity where we see this behavior. We have not exhausted the whole phase space where you will see or you will not see. But that should be a relevant variable. Yeah.
They're traveling a long distance. Is it possible that the particles, like, they are walking and they are moving? If you want to design a system that they specifically move left and right in traveling a long distance, is it possible?
So that's what I call intelligent particles. We have stupid particles. They all move in the same direction, but that direction can be left or right. There is no preference. So if you do 100 experiments, which a student did, 50 will go one way, 50 will go other way, law of averages. But what you are asking is something very, very exciting, not answers are not known. You can now take chirality into view. So as you all know, chirality is very, very important in biology. So question now is, can you couple chirality to activity? Then you, if you have two different chiral particles, you know chiral particles, right? Student, which mean left-handed and right-handed, like sugar molecules. They will look, image is different from the real one, from the actual one. If one is left-handed, one is right-handed. These chiral molecules will behave very differently when they move.
The other question I want to ask, that in the slide you showed, while you are decreasing the angle, particles are getting trapped.
Correct.
I am thinking that the species are not having chance to go here and there, so they are getting entrapped.
No, it's not that simple. First, when we start the experiment, they are all over. Now what happens, when some of them gets it, a trap seen, they go inside, they cannot come out. Right? But that probability of getting trapped is high only if it below a critical angle.
It is also high if the species, the number of the species are more. The number of the species is less, so it can go and it can come back.
That is there, but the right quantity is the angle. We have shown that. It's not the size alone, you are right. But it is really, so what happens is, supposing you have a wedge, physically, this particle is coming, and this particle can rotate and escape. It will never get trapped. So this angle of catchment has to be sufficient, but not too large to get trapped. That's why the critical angle comes. So it's a very interesting physics of competition, whether it can go back, or once it goes back, poor guy has no choice but to get jailed. So it has a choice.
Sir, I want to ask that if we are vibrating the particles, so they will possess kinetic energy and some of the potential energy also. So when they are moving, is the transfer of kinetic energy from one particle to another is playing role in their movement or not?
Good question, but here it is slightly simpler. Here, there is no momentum conservation in this problem because it's a damping system. So all the momentum is absorbed by the plate. So it's not like that they are transferring the momentum to another particle. So it's not like an elastic collision. So that's why this problem is more to be viewed with the energy being given by the plate. Particles are getting energy and moving. As long as you give energy, particles will move. And that is the only relevant variable. It's exactly like food consumed by bacteria. So in bacteria, as long as you keep on giving food, they will be alive. After that, they'll die. In our case, as long as the plate moves, plate stops, life stops.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, it is a very fabulous talk. I have a question, this very basic question regarding this, that you have mentioned that this entropically favorable process, this is how there is some enthalpically role is there in process or not? Enthalpy is playing a role in or not here in this flocking process?
In the flocking?
Yes.
So as I said, I'll again repeat, entropy we are not invoking here. So what we are saying is actually in, so this is, okay, it's slightly a technical way of answering, but let me say it. In what we have done so far is non-equilibrium situation, because you are giving energy all the time. Life is non-equilibrium. You are and I are living because we are a non-equilibrium system. If we are in equilibrium, you know where your place will be, right? Somebody will be crying if you get into equilibrium. So equilibrium is a dead thing. What we are doing is a non-equilibrium situation. We are giving energy all the time, which you can call enthalpy or whatever it is. And we are not invoking entropy to explain the flocking. So if it was a equilibrium physics, you will say it's a competition between enthalpy and entropy. But entropy is also there in non-equilibrium physics. It's not that. That's how the theorem comes. But in, not in this problem.
Yeah. Yes.
Any more?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah.
When they use, they generate the magnetic field and another one will follow that. That is the interaction. And in this experiment,
Right. I agree with you. Actually, that's what my last slide was. What is the basic reason for flocking? You have to see what is the microscopic origin. All birds do not have this magnetic things. They do because of the hydrodynamic gain. But what you are saying is right. When the birds fly 2,500 kilometers from one continent to other, there are theories which show that the magnetic field dictates them. So here we are not invoking any of that. I just want to make a point in this so that I don't miscommunicate the message. The message which I want to communicate is that in physics experiment, what we present or any matter for any natural science, we try to get a minimal picture of this complicated phenomena. Details are important, but not in a majority way. And the famous example you all know is Brownian motion. Have you heard of Robert Brown? When you put some clay or dust in water, it moves Brownian, and Einstein wrote the formula and Langevin, and so many people have done wonderful work. Before that Robert Brown experiment, people used to think, and that's how the textbooks were, how do you differentiate living and non-living objects? And one standard answer was, anything that moves is living, anything which is static is non-living. And Robert Brown showed that that's not needed. You can have this Brownian motion from the thermal agitation of solvent molecules. And it completely made a new paradigm of this Brownian motion. So that's where the power of this understanding. So at that level, we are asking the question on flocking. What is the minimal understanding, minimal interaction, minimal model, which is enough? Not the details, what you're saying, which are important. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Will that enough?
Yeah, any question?
Sir, it was a nice talk. Is there any flocking phenomena in the movement of electrons in our circuit?
No, that's a very different physics. So don't confuse with that. Electrons moving.
Yes.
So you have the diffusive motion and all that. I'm not confusing. So I want to again say,
in this, what we are looking at is the situation where we are feeding energy. So it is out of equilibrium and then moving. Now in electron case, you can also give energy through electric field and they will move. That's what you call electrophoresis or whatever you have electric motion. That has collective behavior. The electrons behave collectively. That's a different physics, but they also move collectively and that's how you get superconductivity. So you have a cooperative state in electrons. You have many other phenomena, this is beautiful physics, which Professor Pathak was saying. That is a different thing. We are not looking at flocking in that. It doesn't help us to invoke that language. Yeah.
Sir, it's a wonderful talk, first of all. And sir, I have only one general question that you are trying to model the natural things, natural phenomena like flocking. But in experiments that you did is you are providing vibration particular to the particles. How the things, I mean to say that from where, because in the natural things, there is no vibration that is coming over there.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, I understand.
So what is the principle of modeling?
Let me say that what we are doing is we are inspired by phenomena occurring in nature. Now in the laboratory, you have to of course work. You can't just create flocking, say I want flocking. No, it won't happen. You have to create conditions where you have to give energy and you have to make them communicate. That is what is being done in our experiment. So when I say we are mimicking nature, nature is inspiring us the phenomena. How we do it in the laboratory is what I presented. I hope it's clear.
Yeah, another thing I would like to suggest to you that suppose just a suggestion, because you say that it doesn't have any applications, but the thing is that
I showed you stampede. It has applications. Yeah.
And, because you can translate the shape kind of things to the bacteria, because the bacteria in humans, they have different kind of actions.
Correct.
So you
no,
can...
No, I completely agree.
Yeah.
And even the effect which we have shown, separation of active particles, has implications for bacterial separation.
And so the thing is that concept is you can mimic the shapes of different bacteria, suppose pathogenic, how they...
Yeah. So we will not be... you are very right. So that's what I said. It has message now back to biology. Biology inspired us to do some physics. Now we probably may have some message backwards. Answer what you're saying is right. Yeah.
I think there has been enough questions. So yes, please. Last.
There's no question, sir. The question you had raised earlier. Why do we flock together?
Provide excellent scientific answers for that, sir. The question still remains. Why the scientists here have flocked together in Chandigarh? Why have they flocked together in Chandigarh? The way I look at it, I'm connected with CRIC also, and I happen to interact with some of the scientists. I personally feel there's a fertile environment in Chandigarh with a large number of scientific laboratories here, research scholars here. You have what you need is some kind of an environment, certain conditions or some motivations, vibrations and the numbers which will align together to a particular objective you want to fulfill. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I just want to say one thing, that this is not the first lecture I have presided for Ajay Sood, as he told that he was a student in physics department, Punjab University, and that was my second year I started teaching, 71-72 batch. He was the student, Grover was Purushottam Gupta, who was the CATS director in Indore. They were a very bright student in the class, and they have performed very well. And in the last lecture of Ajay Sood at Physics Department, Punjab University, I said that I was in a governing council meeting of the Indian Association for Cultivation of Science, Calcutta, and he was awarded there the excellent science award at that time. Then in Chandigarh, I repeated that next time he will be FRS, and he has come here after becoming the FRS. And I wish and hope that the next time he will, well, not next time, sooner or later he will have higher awards, which is ultimate in the science. And we are very proud of him to being the our students and my students. And I have been closely interacted with him for over a period of 45 years since he was here. And several occasions we have touched each other's life. So I'm very happy to be indeed, and thank Tilak Raj Sharma, Inder Veer Singh Pasi for asking me to preside over this lecture.
Thank you.
I think
so thank you, Professor Pathak, and thank you, Professor Sood, for such an enlightening talk. So now I would request the gathering to join me to thank you, Professor Ajay Sood, for such an interesting talk by giving him a standing ovation, please. Thank you all. So now we would like to felicitate our guests for the day. So I would like to request our ED sir and Professor Pasi to please felicitate Professor Ajay K. Sood by presenting him shawl and memento. Please. I would like to request Professor Pasi and sir to felicitate Professor Pathak, please. Thank you, sirs. Now I would like to request Dr. Pandey to propose vote of thanks for today's function, please.
Thank you, Mahinder. Speaker of the day, respected Professor A.K. Sood, FRS INSA President, Professor K.N. Pathak, former VC Punjab University, Professor Inderbir Singh Pasi, Chairman for NASI Chandigarh Chapter, Director Tia Sharma, NABI, and CIAB, students and scholars. I would take this opportunity to place on record a hearty thanks to Professor A.K. Sood, who most graciously accepted our invitation to deliver this public lecture at NABI and CIAB facility. We express our gratitude to Dr. Sood for giving an excellent lecture on why do we flock together, actually. By using a simple, nice introduction, laying the foundation of the talk, and eventually explaining in a simple, minimalistic physics methodology to explain the basic principle of why we flock together. He also shared different examples, how this can be interpreted to different birds, inanimate objects, and wide variety of human behaviors. Needless to say, today's talk is the most appropriate day for the day present. That represent a perfect amalgam of research thoughts that could benefit the young students. Now, of course, we have a lot of school students here who will be benefiting for catalyzing their thoughts and minds towards innovative research. We are also grateful to Dr. Pasi, president for Chandigarh chapter NASI, for providing us the pride to host Dr. Sood lecture at our facility. I would also thank Professor Patek for moderating this session and taking the question from the students. In the end, we extend our thanks to Dr. T.S. Sharma, who is a guiding force behind today's event. We cannot thank him enough for his encouragement, prompting scientists and students for organizing such a beautiful lecture. Thanks to all the delegates from the Tri-City area, the directors, former VC for Punjab University, Dr. Grover here, for attending and graciously been showing this presence. We acknowledge the contribution from the students' administration for making the event successful. Thank you very much, all. Thank you.
May I request all of you to please stand up for the national anthem?
Punjab, Sindh, Gujarat, Maratha, Dravida, Uttar, Ganga, Vindhya, Himachal, Yamuna, Ganga, Utsal, Jalandhi, Ganga. Tab Shubh Naame Jaage, Tab Shubh Aashish Maange, Gaave Tab Jal Gaatha. Jan Jan Mangal Dayak Jay Hind Bharat Bhag Vidhata Jay Hind Jay Hind Jay Hind Jay 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 Hind.
Thank you all. So I have two announcements to make, please. NABI and CIAB has displayed their technologies in the reception area of this building at the ground floor. So I will request everyone on their way out to have a look around and see those technologies. And also we have made arrangements for high tea outside. So I would request everyone to have high tea. And our doors are not the way Professor Sood was explaining. So when you flock there, be careful.